of the prize of the upward calling of God in Christ Jesus. I press on. You know what I like about that? Is there's so many things in our lives that we cannot control. That are like things you have to have just faith. God's going to have to do it. I'm going to have to give it to God. But this one, he gave to me. It's my job to press on. He can't make me press on. He can encourage me in his word, but he cannot make me. This is something I can do. I can actually hold. I'm that kind of guy. Many people, I've talked to a couple people like that today, that like to have a modicum of control in what happens in life. Guilty. I like this because God's saying, yeah, your life is crazy, but I'm going to give you something here. He said, I can do this. I haven't mastered it yet. I haven't mastered it yet. But one thing I do, I know that I am going to press on. I'm going to forget what's behind. I'm going to forget what has been out of my control. Because what did we say about last week? The past is out of your control. The only thing that you can actually purposefully and intentionally affect is the now. So I'm going to press on, forgetting what is behind and straining for what lies ahead. What lies ahead? The upward call in Christ Jesus. That means it's higher. It's a higher call. And I think we need to make that our goal for the year. When you got new life in Jesus Christ, what did it feel like? Think about that for a second. Remember? Remember? Remember that? Good. Now forget it. You can't go back to that. You can't go back to that. All you can do is strain on for the new, the upward calling. We live our lives in the rearview mirror so much. We got to look ahead. We've got to look ahead. This is not what you want. You do not want your brightest days to be in your rear view. We live like that. We long for the past, the good old days. We're going to Disney in a couple weeks. And the theme of Disney World's Hollywood studios there was the Hollywood that never was and always will be. Because it didn't. The way we remember glamorous things is that they didn't really exist. It's just how we've constructed them in our minds. I think that's how we, the life that always, never was, but always will be in our heads was so great. These whippersnappers these days, they don't have a clue. Every street was uphill. No matter whether you're going or coming. They were all uphill, and they all had snow on them. But we did it, because it was better back then. Snow plows. Poor Brian's been dealing with snow plows all night. But I just want to put that in your mind. We don't want our brightest days to be in the rear view. We want them to be ahead. And there's some precedent for that in Scripture. I want you to open up to Genesis chapter 19. Hopefully you're good to Roman numerals this series. 19. And we're going to start in verse 12. We're going to start in verse 12. I'm going to do two, excuse me. It's getting there. And it says this. Now, this is the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. And so I'll set the story up for you who can't remember. Sodom and Gomorrah, bad. Very bad. And God So bad that God says, the cry against this city of the plains, these cities, it actually was the cities of the plains. The cry has gone out to heaven against these cities so long and so hard because of their wickedness that they have exhausted my grace, they've exhausted my mercy, and I am going to obliterate them. That's what he said. But God had a special relationship with Abraham. So he goes to Abraham and he says, Abraham, Abe, buddy, old pal, I know you got a nephew there in the city. Get him out, because it's going to be bad. You don't want him there. And then there's a whole series of Abraham making deals with God about the amount of people that he would spare the cities for. And it come down to the fact that there wasn't even like five people in the whole city that were righteous. So God says two angels into the city of the plains to get Lot and his family out. Well, that's where we start. So we start in verse, I think it said 12, right? Yeah, 12. Here we go. Then the man said to Lot, have you anyone else here? Sons-in-law, sons, daughters, or anyone who have in the city? Bring them out of this place, for we are about to destroy this place. Think about the power those people, those two guys had. Wow. For we are about to destroy this place because the outcry against its people has become great before the Lord, and the Lord has sent us to destroy it. So Lot went out and said to his son-in-law who were to marry his daughters, up, get out of this place, for the Lord is about to destroy the city. But he seemed to his son-in-laws to be jesting. Just joking. Not really going to destroy it, right? That's crazy talk. Two people going to destroy her? See, that's funny, Lot. Okay, so keep going. As the morning dawned, the angels urged Lot, saying, up, take your wife and your two daughters who are here, lest you be swept away in the punishment of the city. But he lingered. What? He lingered. Why did he linger? I don't know. It seems kind of crazy to me, but he lingered. So the men seized him and his wife and his two daughters by the hand, the Lord being merciful to him, and they brought him out and set him outside the city. Okay, stop there for a second. This is basically salvation by kicking and screaming. Mercy by the dragging of one's hair. These people are being saved not because of themselves, but because of Abraham. They literally have to drag this family out. What is it about this place that causes them to want to be involved in the destruction of the place? Stop. Look inside. What is it about us that keeps us pinned down to longing for, loving, not wanting to give up this world? What does it have for us that constantly causes us to linger? We look at this story and say, they're so stupid. Why do they just not get out of there? When I read this story, I had to take a long look in the mirror. What keeps me from being sold out for God? What keeps me from going and running towards his salvation instead of lingering and languishing in what is going to be destroyed and is destroying me? You see, the progression of Lot into Sodom was a slow migration. He pitched his tents towards Sodom. Then he lived in Sodom. And by the time these angels come, he's sitting in the gates of Sodom, which is code, Bible, Old Testament code for he was a leader in the city of Sodom. He was a judge or a magistrate. Oof. But we've all been there. We've all been there. We've all pitched our tents towards wickedness. We've all gone that way. We've all flirted with it. And it's gotten a hold of us. And then it's been something that we've not only associated with, but now we are participating in wholeheartedly. And then Christ comes to us and gives us a message of salvation. And it's for our very own good, yet we linger. Let's keep going. Oh, man, for us. Verse 23. The sun had risen on the earth when Lot came to Zoar. Then the Lord rained on Sodom and Gomorrah sulfur and fire from the land out of heaven. And he overthrew those cities and all the valley and all the inhabitants of the cities. And there was and what grew on the ground. So he didn't just obliterate the cities. The whole thing was just decimated. But Lot's wife behind him looked back. She looked back. And she became a pillar of salt. For the sake of this message, she was living her life in the rear view. It was so good back there. I miss it. I loved that. She longed for what was destroyed instead of straining on towards the higher calling of what was in front of her. She was saved from destruction. She had so much that she could have accomplished, so much that was in front of her, yet she couldn't take her eyes out of the rear view. Ooh, that's challenging to me. That's challenging to me. What happened to her? She turned into a pillar of salt. Why? I don't know. What's with the salt pillar? You know, like, Lot has, I don't know. It's just weird. It doesn't say in the Bible that there was, if you look back, you're going to turn into salt. It doesn't say that. But it does make a point. Many people who live their lives in the review are paralyzed and cannot move forward. They are like a pillar set into the ground. And they can never move on. We have got to break free of that longing for what's... Even the good things of the past can cause us to get stuck. I don't know how many times I've heard this. But man, my life has gone so far from where I used to be. I remember when I first got saved. The feeling I had. Well, that's great. Guess what? You cannot go back. All you have is the future, the present, and the problem with the future is that it's dim. It's hard to see. We can't actually see the future. All we can see is what could be. It's like a shadow of what could be. And that's scary to us. But the fact of the matter is, that's all we got. We have now, and we have what's coming up. And all we can do is invest in that. So, get out of the past. You know, I have a feeling that Lot's wife was very much into what was going on in Sodom. And the evil things of Sodom were pulling at her heartstrings. But maybe not. Maybe she had a nice home where she raised her two daughters. Maybe there's some great memories back there. And it pulled at her. I don't know. But whatever it was, it caused her to be disobedient and to long for what was behind. The Bible says, forget what's behind. He also says a lot of times, remember. Remember what I did to get you to the next spot. That's what he's asked you to remember. When he always pushes us back to in memory, He talks about how he took us from one place to the next. Remember how I can do that. Remember how I took you out of Egypt. Remember how I was able to take you from point A to point B. Now you're in point B. Let's get on to point C. Let's keep moving. My power is still working. I can get you out of where you're at. I can bring you to a new place. I can make what's coming up better than what was behind. But you got to get your eyes out of the rear view. Got to press on. Press on, press on. And this is great for a church that's moving to something new. That's great. But I want you to do it here too. I need to do it here too. What could 2017 be for this? If we would embrace the new. If you're being honest with yourself, I can guarantee you could say to yourself, there are things in my life that I have not given over to God. I have just held on to them because they're, I don't know, they have some kind of a sentimental attachment to my past life. Forget them. Get on with it. What would happen this year if we completely embraced the way of the cross? If we completely embraced the kingdom of God, what would happen? I guarantee that it would pale in comparison to the things that you're holding on. The things you're holding on to would pale in comparison to what God has for you. That's what I meant to say. So here we go. I'm not going to leave you with a negative. I'm going to put you in a positive place today. The future is pale because we haven't gotten there yet. The past is in technicolor because we've already been there, and we have, not only have we been there, but we have, our memories of it have blown it way out of proportion. Right? I'm going to ask you today to not fear the future. Don't fear the future. When God pointed people back, it was only to emphasize his ability to influence the future. It's the same God. The same God who divided the Red Sea is working on your behalf today. Your future is not bleak in God. Your future has unlimited potential in him. I don't care how old you are. Isaiah 43 says this, "Fear not, I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine." That doesn't excite you. I don't know. "When you pass through the waters, I will be with you." Doesn't say there's not going to be some waters in your way. Just says, watch them part. Just watch them part, man. Don't be afraid of them. Just step in. Just like the priest did in the Jordan. What did he do? It rolled back. That's not natural for water. "And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fires, you will not be burned." Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. "And the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior." It is so ridiculous to believe that he would go to the lengths he went to save us and yet not sustain us. Oh, yeah, the whole sustaining part, that's on you. No, don't be afraid. It says, fear not, don't be afraid. A little farther down, it says, "Remember not the former things," verse 18, "nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing what? A new thing. Now it springs forth." And I love this, how he ends this. "Do you perceive it?" Do you perceive? Can you see it? I'm doing a new thing in you. All it takes is you perceiving it and stepping out in it. Don't be afraid. Step out. I'm the same God. Do you know me? Do you trust me? Don't be afraid. I've overcome this world. Don't let your brightest days be in your rear view. Hebrews 12:1. "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, This is talking about, this particular verse is referencing the Hall of Fame chapters of Hebrews, where it talks about all these people who are overcomers because of their faith in God. It was counted as Abraham as righteousness because he believed. And it talks about Noah and Abraham and all these people of the faith. Since we have their examples, so we're surrounded by so great cloud of witnesses, that should be an example to us, because the same God is that was with them is with us. Let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Therefore, I love this part. Lift your drooping hands. Love that. This is us, by the way. This is part that we can do. We couldn't do the salvation part. That was Jesus' thing. He's like, because of this stuff, now I have something for you to do. Lift your drooping hands and strengthen your weak knees. Stop biting your fingernails about the future. Right? And make straight paths with your feet. Know what that means? Vision. You're not going to get anywhere unless you plan your journey. And you let God be God. We talked about this last week. I'm not preaching over last week's sermons. You got to redeem the time. You got to make a plan. Make straight paths for your feet. Just make sure they're God-honoring paths. And he might send you on a detour to the right or to the left at one point. That's fine. But if you don't start somewhere, you don't have a path, a direction to go, you are a pillar. You got to break free. And make straight paths for your feet so that what is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather be healed. Strive for peace with everyone and for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. What does it look like to embrace the kingdom of God? The way of the cross. When was the last time you said, this year, I'm going to be super Christian? Not that I will attain it, but I'm going to make a path for that. I'm going to be the guy who follows Christ to the best of my ability. And I'm going to lay aside all the weights that so encumber me. I love that word, they encumber me. Right? And I'm going to run this race. What race? The race that Christ has set before us. And I'm going to stop doing this. That's what we do. That's what we do. In New York City, they still, for some reason, I don't understand this, folks. Why in the world are they still using horses for the police department in New York City? Have we not gotten, like, motorcycles and vehicles? They still use horses. I think it's kind of cool, actually. But in New York City, they have this problem with the horses because it's a busy place. There's a lot, if you've been in New York City, there's a lot to distract you from your purpose. So they put blinders on the horses. They put two little leather patches on the side of the face so that the horses are focused on the path ahead. And they're not sure, because what happens is they get distracted. The guy on the horse that wants to go there is ending up going over here. So they have to be intentional about how they direct their horse and how they keep him focused. Folks, sometimes we get so distracted, and that's the job of the enemy, to distract. You know what? Your salvation, your eternity, he has no hold over that any longer. So what is he going to try to do? He's going to try to make you ineffective, distracted. He's going to make you question the joy of your salvation. He's going to try to keep you from writing down five names on the list and really praying for it. He's going to, you know, instead of taking the time to do the things, the disciplines that cause you to thrive in God, he's going to, you know, make you binge watch something on Netflix. Guilty. You see what I'm saying? There's so much out there to distract us. It's like driving a horse through Times Square. What I'm saying to you today is, what would it look like if you gave 2017 to God and said, I'm not going to be so easily distracted this year. I'm going to set a straight path to my feet. I'm going to let God heal me. I'm going to strengthen my arms and my legs in Christ. And I'm going to embrace the new. What would it look like? I'm trying to understand what it looks like myself, that's my goal for this year. Is to make 2017 a year that is unlike any year before. I won't forget those years. And I want to move into something new in Christ Jesus. He's doing a new thing. How do I embrace the new? It's so great for pastors to give all this stuff, information, and then like, all right, have a good day. Figure it out. Let me give you a very concise passage of scripture that gives you a framework of what it looks like to embrace the new. Romans 12, and you've heard this before. And this is Paul giving the same talk I'm giving today. Ready? I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your spiritual worship. Instead of 2017, he's doing it in like 17. This is the same talk. Do not be conformed to those to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that you may test. By testing, you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable. And he is saying, in a much more concise and without using metaphors of blinding horses, exactly what I'm trying to tell you. Don't be conformed to, don't be distracted. Don't let the world be your puppet master. Cut the strings and let's get moving. And then he goes on to instruct. And this is the part that I want to leave you with here. And I want you to read this passage sometime this week, okay? Verse 9 through 21 of Romans chapter 12. Here we go. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. These are not crazy concepts, folks. If it's evil, get rid of it. If it's good, embrace it. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not be slothful in zeal. It means go get it. Don't. There's so many things that slow us down. We were talking about this morning. Just get out of my way. I want to go. Don't be slothful in zeal. What it would look like if you were zealous for the things of God this year? Like, really zealous about it. Now, here's the thing. My zeal is my zeal. Okay, I'm not going to come to Wanda and go, Wanda, we got to talk about your zeal. Okay? You're not meeting the same level of zeal that I appreciate, so we are going to judge your zeal right now. And, you better step it up. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. We don't do that. It's about you. One of the things that does distract us is looking at everybody else. I don't know where you're at today. You may be very new to this whole thing. Well, whatever that zeal, man, go for it. Somebody who has known the Word of God for many years, their zeal, their level of zeal, their level of accomplishment may go farther than yours. Don't look at them and say, oh, man, I failed. No! If you are even taking that step in that direction, you are succeeding. We don't want to look at each other and gauge. We just want to look at the cross and say, God, help me to be what you've called me to be. Be fervent in the spirit. Serve the Lord. And I would just stop there for a second. Got a lot of things for you to do this year. Let's serve the Lord together. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Oh. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. Repay no evil for evil, but give thought to what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. That means our habits, our Facebook habits, are going to have to change. Christians are the worst. We really are. Christianity has become a political party. And we feel it's like okay to just lambaste people over social media. That's on you. As far as it concerns you, live at peace with everybody. Everybody? Even the political party that I don't agree with? Everybody. As far as it depends on you. You can't control them. You can control yourself. Beloved, never avenge yourselves. Ouch. But leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine and I will repay, says the Lord. If you have any concerns about that, just go back to the Genesis passage we read today. He's got it taken care of. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. He is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head. That's a sermon for another day. Do not be overcome by evil. I love this passage, how it ends. Do not be overcome by evil. Overcome evil with good. Again, that's something he's given us. Do you see that? There are certain things in Scripture that we cannot do, that only God can do. But there are certain things in Scripture that he gives to us. Don't be overcome by evil. Well, I can't do that. Yes, you can. Sin has no more control over you. You are not a slave any longer to sin. You are more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. You can do it. I didn't say it's going to be easy. But he says, and on the other side of it, you can overcome evil. What? With good. 2017. Let's embrace the new. The new life that God has given us. Let's really go after it. Let's find out what it looks like. We might have never even tested it. We might not even know what it looks like to really live a full year, a full span of time, giving ourselves over to the Holy Spirit and to God's plan for our lives. If you start now, should the Lord tarry, by 2018, you might not even recognize you now. Wouldn't that be nice? I'm saying, folks, let's get to it. I don't know about you, but I'm sick of being lukewarm. As a church, maybe we are, I don't know. I just feel like I could be hotter. How many people agree with me that they could be hotter? I'm not talking about looking in the mirror. Aww. How many people think that they could be more on fire? And we, you know what we do so many times? I'm going to be done. You know what we do so many times? We sit back and we say, okay, Holy Spirit, your job. Do it, you know, if you want me to be hotter, then, you know, give me a tongue of flame or something. I don't know. That's not what any of the scriptures that we talked about today talk about. It talks about making straight paths, getting on it. The Holy Spirit will come, will thrive, will live through you, but you got to embrace it. You got to throw off. It didn't say the Holy Spirit's going to tear them off of you. It says throw off every weight that so easily encumbers you. You got to throw it off. And then, wow, look out. Because a clean vessel that God can pour through is going to make an amazing impact for the kingdom of God. So my encouragement today is, do you want to be a little hotter? I want to be a lot hotter. I want to be more on fire for God. And I want the Holy Spirit to have a place where it can move in me. I don't want any hindrances. I don't want to grieve the Holy Spirit. I want to give any hindrance to the Holy Spirit. I want to be a place where the Holy Spirit can work and move in powerful ways through this earthen vessel. If that's you today, I would ask you to just close your eyes and just meditate for a second. Not meditate, just think for a second. just think. What does that future look like? Now, I know it's dim. I know it's shrouded in uncertainty because it's the future. But what could it be? What are some of the paths that you think that maybe God would like me to go down this year? That's why in our logo for this year, there's a road that goes, it's dimly lit, but it goes off into the future. There's a path, a straight path made for the feet. And the Roman numeral 17 is bright and shining because that's what's ahead of us. That's what we're in right now. So what might it look like? What might it look like? And I want to pray for you today. If you say today, I want to be more on fire for the kingdom of God. I want this year to be a year that was like no other year because I was intentional about making a path, about seeking the future and embracing the new. If that's you today, raise your hand. Hey, put it down. I want you to know that just about every hand in this place went up. Just about every hand went up. Oh, mine needs to go up too. Yeah, mine too. Folks, look out. If that's truly the desire of the majority of the people in here, look out. 2017, what's going to happen? I don't know, but it's going to be awesome. Let's embrace what it is. Let me pray for you. Dear Jesus, I ask that you be with me today. And my brothers and sisters in Christ, Lord, we want to be on fire for you. We want to embrace the future that you have for us. We don't want to live our lives in the rear view, whether we're looking at past experiences that have been so good and we're just holding on to that we can't even see what's ahead because we just wish it was like that. Or maybe it's something that bad that happened in our life in the past that is just causing us to freeze in the place where a pillar of salt in the present. God, help us to break free and embrace your plan, your purpose, your principles, your disciplines, and live this year like no other year, embracing the person of Jesus Christ and the plan that you have for us. God, and when we do that as individuals, and then we channel that as your church, we will be more than conquerors. The gates of hell will not be able to stand against your church. So God, I pray right now that you would breathe into us a fresh and new start today, that you would give us the power of your Holy Spirit to keep this commitment this year. And we give at the very onset of this year, we give you ourselves afresh and anew. And Lord, we will be intentional about embracing who you are this year. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let me just give you a word of warning here. A word of warning. The enemy hates this type of talk. He just hates it. And what's going to happen is this. You're going to be going down this path, and you're going to be getting some momentum. And then you're going to have a setback. And that's all the enemy is going to let you think about for the next 6 months. Don't let it happen. Put it behind you. Press on. Aren't you glad that you are, by God's grace, forgiven from the things that you will do? Don't let it be a stumbling block to your future. Press on. Press on. Press on. Embrace the new. God bless. Have a wonderful week.